again, everyone, and welcome to this week's edition of MRN Out Loud. It's presented by Money Lion and also brought to you by Hercules Tires. As we draw ever closer to the return of real on-track NASCAR racing, coming up, we have two former racers turned broadcasters on the program. Ricky Craven has said this will be his last season with Fox Sports, where he's an analyst, and we just had to find out why. But first, Kyle Petty will join us as he prepares to resume his duties as an analyst for NBC. He's got a new record out. That's right, Kyle's making music again. And this time it's to help feed hungry people. Plus, we'll talk a little racing as we get set for a return and find out what both think about Matt Kenseth coming back to replace Kyle Larson. A quick timeout, then Kyle Petty is first up.
Did you know that banks collected over $15 billion in unnecessary bank fees last year? Come on, enough is enough. It's time we took back control of our finances. That's why MoneyLion is proud to bring you the Financial Crew Chief and to be a NASCAR sponsor. Look, no one knows more about hard work and pursuing their dreams than NASCAR fans, drivers, and teams. So we want to bring you the kind of banking that the big banks would never build, with features like zero-fee checking and zero-fee investment accounts. And because life is also meant for a join, with MoneyLion, NASCAR fans get even more. We're giving away 1,500 NASCAR tickets to our members this year. Plus, you can get 5% cash back on NASCAR tickets, at track purchases, and all purchases at NASCAR.com. Learn more at MoneyLion.com or download our app. This is America's most powerful financial membership. MoneyLion, here we roar.
Kyle Petty joins us now, and normally we'd talk some racing, and we'll get to that, but right now we want to talk to you, Kyle, in your capacity as a musician. I know you've been playing some shows more and more frequently, but now, for the first time I've seen in recent memory, you've put out a new recording, but there is an ulterior motive. You're trying to help feed some people, right?
Yeah, you know, it's funny. David Childers and I have been doing shows for the last couple of years, really the first part of the year, before my NBC stuff starts, and I talk about racing, but we did six or seven shows this year before the coronavirus came out, kind of put a stop to all live music all over the world. But so I had written a song called Hard Times probably about 12 years ago during the financial crisis. I was watching the news one night and I wrote this song and I play it in my show, and it's kind of a sad song, but it's a commentary on what was going on at the time. And Dolph Ramsor, that handles the Avett brothers and those guys, he called one day and he said, "Hey, you and David have been doing this. How about you want to do something with it?" And we started talking and brainstorming. And the next thing I know, boom, we've put out a split single.
Now, that means that you're on one side and David's on the other, right?
David's on the other side.
For people who don't know what a record is.
yeah, for people that don't remember 45s, they know what a record is. That's right. It is a split single, and it's called, David's song is called Quiet in the House of the Rising Sun. Mine is called Hard Times. It's a $3 download at Ramsor Records, and we're sending all the money will go to Loaves and Fishes, which is a local organization of food banks here in Mecklenburg County, and it is directly... The food goes directly to the people. And what I mean by that is if they buy a box of apples, it goes from them to a family. A box of oatmeal from them to the family. It's not sitting in a warehouse. It's a pass-through. And they do tremendous, tremendous work. And in these hard times, people need those food banks. They need those food pantries. So I think David and myself and Dolph all felt like it was the perfect opportunity to be able to just do something and hopefully raise a little money.
We've seen the news stories about the lines at some of the food banks around the country, and it's just amazing how many people that you would not expect to find themselves in need now do during these hard times. I mean, I don't think any of us have ever seen anything like this before.
Obviously, I haven't. And it harkens back for me, and it's funny because talking to my dad, talking to guys that are 80s in their 80s and those that age that were born before World War II, they remember some of that vaguely, times from rationing and things like that. But this is as close as we've had anything. And it's not just us. It's not just here in North Carolina. It's not just here in the Southeast. It's not just here in America. It's all over the world. This is affecting. So this is global. This is something that we have never seen, and I pray we never see again. But if you are in a position to help and help others in any way, shape, or form, because there's a line in the song that says, "All before the grace of God, there stands me or you." And that's kind of the way it is right now. But for the grace of God, if we can help other people, that's good.
Well, check it out at Ramsour Records. And Kyle, before we talk a little racing, this would ordinarily be the time where you guys would be gearing up for the annual charity ride. But again, circumstances didn't allow that to happen. So is it just postponed for this year? I think you're going to go next year, right?
Next year. Same route, same hotels, same places, do the same thing. We just bumped it back and just postponed it and moved it ahead. And that's kind of the way it is. Last year was our 25th anniversary ride. You know, this happened and it is what it is. And we move on. And Morgan had worked tirelessly to get everything done. It's crazy that it takes 7-8 months to put the thing together. And it still took probably 45 days or so for her to dismantle. It takes just as long to take one apart as it does to put it together. So she's been working during this time at home, during the stay-at-home orders, to kind of get that thing sorted out and get it ready for next year. But yes, you know, and that affects the camp. That affects Victory Junction, because we are the biggest. We are the most continuous, the largest fundraiser for Victory Junction. So the ripple effect of what is going on in this country right now, from restaurants to camps to everything that goes on, is just a huge ripple effect.
Let's get to a little bit of racing, Kyle. Looks like we're getting closer and closer to coming back now with some races in the Charlotte area at first that can be driven to. What kind of a process do you think it's going to be to reboot this whole thing?
I don't know. But I think we as an industry, meaning from TV to radio to the media to the competitors to the fans, we have to be open to whatever it is. You know what I mean? Whatever it is. It's not in our power. It was taken away. It's gone. And we're going to get it back. But what are we going to get back? And everybody talks about the new normal. Everybody talks about what normal is. I think when we first come back, this is not going to be the race you saw at Vegas. This is not going to be the race you saw at Martinsville last year. This is not going to be the races you saw at Charlotte or Darlington or the local races, as you mentioned earlier, that we saw. This is going to be a little bit different animal. And we have to be open to those changes. I'm excited for it. I'm just excited to see cars on the racetrack that are real cars, not virtual cars. Okay. I want to see some real stuff
going on. I'm with you.
Yeah. I want to see some real stuff going on. So I'm excited about that. And I'm open to these changes, but I'm not sure what we're going to see. I'm not sure what the process is on how the teams will go to the racetrack, on how the teams will get home from the racetrack, on what they'll be allowed to do at the racetrack. You know, are we going to see every other pit stall? And, you know, so that you have that social distancing from another team. Are you going to see, you know, on pit road, are we going to see every two or three pit stalls in the garage area? If the cars even go to the garage area, we don't know that they'll even go to a garage area or something. You know, how are the drivers going to interact? What happens if there's an accident? What happens here or there? I think NASCAR has obviously, they have to think through all this. I'm sure they are thinking through all this. I'm sure they have thought through all this, but it's going to be a little bit different animal, and it's going to be exciting to watch. It's going to be fun to see. It's going to be fun to see how it evolves, and it's going to be fun to see how close we can get it to what it was and how quickly what it was comes back.
It's going to be a fascinating process to watch. And let's wrap up with this. Were you as surprised as everyone else that Chip Ganassi picked Matt Kenseth to replace Kyle Larson? I think that kind of was like a big rock in a small pond. Everybody went, wait, what?
I think so. This is what surprises me. Okay. I'm going to give you the Kyle Petty twist on it here. You cannot question Matt Kenseth's ability in a race car. What he can do, what he has done, what he's capable of doing, what he's done at every organization he's ever been at, that speaks volumes about who Matt is. And I love Matt Kenseth. Matt Kenseth is one of my best friends. So I'm going to clarify that and say that right off the bat. But at a time in this sport where we constantly talk about young guns and a shift in the dynamics of the sport and a change in the direction of the sport, I think it speaks volumes when a company like Chip Ganassi goes old school. They don't go to the truck series or the Xfinity series and get one of these young upstarts or get one of these people who we've talked about and who you say, this may be the next guy, this may be the next guy. Well, Chip doesn't want the next guy. He wants the guy that he knows is proven. And I think in this time, in this business, it's still important to put up numbers on the racetrack and be able to do something on the racetrack. And Matt Kenseth, he knows, can get it done on the racetrack. For the partners he has, whether it be McDonald's, whatever it may be, the bank, whether all the partners he has to prove again, Chip does, that he's made a solid decision and that he is putting up what the numbers on the racetrack and the things that should be done for those sponsors. And Matt Kenseth is your guy. For the future, you take a flyer on a young guy. But it's incredibly, I think it speaks volumes for Matt. I think it speaks where Chip's head is, and I think it's going to be good for the sport. I think as many people, I think the surprise factor, like you said, got everybody talking, everybody excited. You know, Ryan Newman coming back, man, there's going to be a lot of stuff going on.
It's almost like every single TV commercial now says, in these uncertain times, you need something you can depend on, right?
Exactly.
Awesome. Kyle, appreciate your time, and good luck with the record and the help for Loaves and Fishes. We'll see you soon on NBC, and look forward to catching your charity ride a year removed from now when it'll be bigger and better than ever before. Appreciate your time.
All right, man. Thank you guys very much. Take care.
Another quick timeout, and we'll be joined by Fox Sports analyst Ricky Craven in our Money Lion Crew Chief segment.
Next time those engines roar, don't just get pumped up. Get 5% cash back with Money Lion. Our members get 5% cash back on up to $2,000 in annual purchases of tickets to a NASCAR race from authorized ticket sellers. You'll also get 5% off any at-track purchases and all purchases on NASCAR.com. Just use your Money Lion debit card, and it couldn't be easier. Join the world's most powerful financial membership, Moneyline. Here we roar.
Wherever you drive, wherever you go, Hercules Tires has the value, selection, and industry-leading warranty to get you there no matter where the road takes you. You can count on Hercules Tires to have your back when times are tough, all while adding money to your pocket. The purchase of 4 qualifying Hercules Tires through May 31st, 2020 could get you up to a $70 Visa prepaid card. Visit HerculesTire.com/springrebate to learn more. That's HerculesTire.com. Hercules Tires, ride on our strength.
Sir, are you aware you were going 40 miles an hour? This is a residential area.
Sure, but I'm on my lawnmower. Wait, am I getting a ticket?
No, I've just never seen anyone top 9 miles an hour on one of those bad boys. And mow their entire lawn in 30 seconds? What got into you?
Well, I did fuel up at Sunoco this morning.
At Sunoco, we know how to fuel peak performance. We've been doing it for American racing for over 50 years. Fuel your best.
Time now for our financial crew chief segment, where we get into the technical side of the sport. It's presented by Money Lion, the world's most powerful financial membership. Money Lion, here we roar. Back on MRN Out Loud, joined by Fox Sports analyst Ricky Craven now, a former driver himself and going through these unprecedented times with us, Ricky. And now that we seem to be getting close to getting back to racing, what kind of thoughts begin to fly through your mind? Because people are speculating it'll be this versus that and what we might see. What do you think is going to happen?
Well, obviously, there's going to be a pent-up demand. And I have to say, a little bit tongue-in-cheek, that the iRacing has been satisfying, but I don't want to spend the rest of my life watching iRacing. You know, I think that's sort of a general opinion, right?
Yep.
So, you know, we want to see our drivers. We want to see our sport back in action. We want to hear the roar of the engines. And I think there's going to be a little bit of a disconnect in, you know, how we pick up where we left off, right? There were certain drivers that had a strong start to the season. There's been some turbulence in between. And then there's going to be like a welcoming for Matt Kenseth to join us. Nobody would have believed that 3 months ago.
Yeah, that's definitely one of the things I wanted to ask you about. I mean, with the iRacing question that you mentioned, it has been huge, right place, right time. You guys on Fox got some huge TV numbers with those, over 1 million, I think, on average now. But it's not been without a little bit of controversy as well. We've seen Bubba Wallace have issues with a sponsor. Kyle Larson have issues with an utterance that wound up costing him his job. I guess it's a take the good with the bad, but it did seem like it went very quickly from fun diversion to full-blown business.
You know, that's an excellent point. It's without question, Kyle Larson has been a casualty of this interruption, this world that we've all been sort of forced into. You make it up as you go. You know, I don't want to head too far down that path because, you know, I'm very sensitive to what happened. But I'm also 54 years old. I remember what it was like to be a young driver in Cup. I remember what it was like to make a lot of money and really not acknowledge it until I got hurt really bad at Texas Motor Speedway. I was on the outside looking in for a long period of time. And when I was able to get back and drive the Tide car, just an incredible opportunity that I was so determined to capitalize on, Woody, I was a better human being. I was a more humble human being. And I was a better driver and person because of all that.
I think we definitely all learn and grow and live, but it's interesting. That brings up the other point. You mentioned Matt Kenseth, and nobody saw that coming. It really did come out of left field. But one of the interesting points that Chip Ganassi made is, here's a guy with no baggage, family man, excellent racer, former champion. But the thing that jumped out at me is, I don't want any controversy right now. This is just a solid guy, great driver. But the stuff that I can't handle right now with sponsorships being what they are, I've got to have a guy who I know is not going to get in hot water.
That's right. I think Chip Ganassi deserves a tremendous amount of credit. And he'll probably get more credit than he might deserve, because obviously it's the execution by all of his soldiers, all of his employees, all of the people that make up CGR that helped bring this together. I didn't see it coming. You know, I pride myself on thinking outside the box, but Matt Kenseth wasn't an obvious solution to me until I heard the whispers. And Matt and I are good friends. The one thing that Matt did that I think made him an option is that Matt, since he hung up his helmet last, has continued to keep himself in very, very good physical condition. I mean, crazy, actually, the regimen that he has and the things that he does. He's probably a better athlete today than he was 5 years ago. I really believe that. So I think that'll help him.
I agree. I'm just thinking, I read where he's running marathons or at least half marathons and things like that. But that brings up another thought. Do you think that with this long layoff, I mean, the younger guys obviously will be an easier transition than the veteran guys. But do you think there's going to be a concern of guys, A, knocking off rust, and B, having a little bit of fatigue behind the wheel, especially if we race multiple times a week?
I think there's been a lot of pizza and potato chips consumed.
Yeah. Here too.
Yeah. So there's probably a little bit of that. I think that there are some drivers that are going to come out of the gate, maybe a little more adept to, you know, they're always a surprises. Always. But the really good drivers and the really good teams will catch up almost immediately. They always do, right? They always do.
When we do get back to that point, a lot of the talk has been, maybe at first at least, some of the places where most of the teams being based in the Charlotte area can drive to, like Darlington, Charlotte Motor Speedway, Martinsville, Bristol's. Is that just going to kind of be the first dip the toe in the water type thing, you think, until we get more information about what areas are open and not, and what travel is going to be like?
I think logistics matter. I'm close enough to enough crew members in the industry to tell you that there's apprehension by some of them to get on an airplane today. And so I've also heard that, that NASCAR and all the people that have equity in the sport have gone through all these different reiterations of a schedule. It's almost like every day they've been making adjustments or alterations, and they want to get it right. And I don't know, Woody, I don't know if you can get it perfect, because these are imperfect times. But I think that everybody will welcome the idea of getting back as soon as possible, provided that, we're relatively safe. And I say relative because you got to be honest, it's an experiment in the very early innings. It's a bit of an experiment, not just for NASCAR, but for the whole country to get back to business.
Yeah, I mean, this whole thing has been like, about when we think we know something or have something figured out, the ground shifts under us and it changes again. So I guess it's going to be maybe not just with racing, but the whole country and the world for that matter, fits and starts, figuring it out in bits and pieces.
I agree.
Well, Ricky, one of the reasons I wanted to talk to you is I saw some people talking about your post on Facebook recently where you said that you planned for this to be your last full-time season, I guess is the proper term now, and what has been a lifetime of NASCAR racing. What is that going to look like, and what led you to that decision at this time?
So I can't tell you exactly what 2021 is going to look like, but I can tell you that I wake up every morning consumed by it, and it's what I qualify as the fourth chapter of my life. The first chapter growing up on a dairy farm in Maine, a million miles away from NASCAR, but I had this tremendous advantage in that my dad competed locally, and at an early age, 5, 6, 7 years old, I made up my mind what I wanted to be. It was that profound. And by God, it worked. And the second chapter would be my driving career. Began at 15, retired at 40. And then by the grace of God, I get an opportunity to go to work for ESPN. 12 years, I transitioned to Fox for 2 more years. And you know, the bottom line is that I feel like I've contributed in the 14 years I've been in this third chapter. I've really enjoyed it, and I've been challenged by it. But Woody, I haven't been in a car competing for 15 years. So there are certain things about my responsibilities that I don't feel as good about as I did 5, 6, 7 years ago. And there's also, there is a burning desire to do something else. There really is. You know, like it drives me. And I don't want to overstay my welcome. So I feel good about being able to leave on my own terms, so to speak.
Yeah, well, that burning desire to do something else is, are there some things on a bucket list that you'd like to tick off, or is it more a just a radical shift in what you do day to day?
No, I'm going to build something, and I'm absolutely going to build something. And I've actually considered this for about 5 years, but now's the right time. Part of it was because I had 8 weeks of sort of being isolated like the rest of the world and plenty of time to think and even overthink. I've shared with people that I watched the 2003 Darlington race on FS1 a few weeks ago. That helped steer me in this direction. 2003 was really the exclamation point, that win, that season. I was so thankful to get the opportunity from Cal Wells to drive the Tide car in 2001. Because I had won in 4 NASCAR divisions. I had essentially done everything in my professional life that I set out to do except win a cup race. And after getting injured in Texas at the Texas Motor Speedway in 1997, I spent 3 years with it, you know, really trying to fight my way back. And so when I won at Martinsville in 2001, my professional world and life was complete. 2 years later, when I won at Darlington, that was about all I had left. I ran 2004. I contributed almost nothing. It was not a good year. And I really wished I had retired at the end of 2003.
Well, Ricky, I know you're going to be a success at what you do. You have the determination to make it happen for sure, and we really appreciate your time and look forward to seeing not only this year, but what comes next, what the next chapter brings for you. So thanks for your time, and good luck going forward.
Yeah, thank you so much.
That's all the time we've got this week. MRN Out Loud was presented by Money Lion and also brought to you by Hercules Tires. I'm Woody Kane, and we'll see you next week.